Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We bless you, Jesus. We glorify you. You're my everything. You are my everything. I owe you life, worship, praise, everything. 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 Oh Lord, you are everything to me.
Beautiful Sunday morning. Why don't you turn around and shake somebody's hand or wave and greet them in the name of the Lord Jesus. The Lord is certainly good, isn't he? The Lord is good. That's what the Bible says. The Bible says the Lord is good. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Just as a reminder, this is our second week in our, what we call our Church Plus program. And we take an opportunity, take advantage of July and August, and divide up on Sunday mornings in all of our different age demographics. If you have children that are pre-K through sixth grade, they're meeting right now in the kids zone. If you have teenagers that are in 7th to 12th grade, they're meeting in the youth room. If you have graduated high school, not crossed the 30-year mark, our young adults are meeting in the guest reception room out that door. And if you are Spanish-speaking or have Spanish-speaking friends, we have a class for them on Sunday mornings, and they are directly behind the platform. You just walk around the corridor in our guest choir practice room. And the cream of the crop is right here. The cream of the crop. So we welcome you. And just shortly, everybody will join together. We'll have a time of worship. Get your Bibles, if you will. And let's turn to the book of Psalms. The book of Psalms. I want to remind you that we are in our new devotional book. Tomorrow starts our second week in our devotional book. 1.2. Turn your neighbor and say 1.2 if you're looking at the pages. Yes, looking at the pages. If you do not have a book, there will be available after the service at the guest reception in the center of the foyer. They're only $5. And if you don't want a book, but you still want the material, then you can download a PDF of all of the devotions off our website, off the front page, clceast.org. At the bottom of the page is not only our adult version, but our youth version and our kids version. And we are encouraging you to participate in that for your own value and good, but also for the corporate value that we get as a body as we move together through the Word of God. Turn to your neighbor and say, that's good stuff right there. Yeah, okay. Psalms chapter 91, please remain seated as we are in our devotional study time. We do read more verses than we can stand for. And that's just a joke. But this is a powerful passage of Scripture that is something that should be near and dear to our hearts. The Bible tells us in Psalms chapter 91, starting at verse number 1, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler, or from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh to thee. O, with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge. Somebody say, he is my refuge. Even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall be no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh to thy dwelling, for he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because he hath set his love above me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him, and with long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Psalms 91. What a powerful, powerful psalm that we should read over and over again. There's no way we got what was in there just now. So we're going to spend the next little while going over it. But we won't even get it all today, because there's so much goodness in that passage of Scripture. And it really focuses around verse number 9. And if we could go back to verse number 9, it really focuses on verse number 9, which is, because thou hast made the Lord, we're talking about you and I, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. Thy habitation. I want to just kind of unpack this chapter this morning and talk to us about the refuge of the secret place. The refuge of the secret place. Why don't we just, while we're seated, why don't we just lift our hands and ask God to touch us today as we get into his word. I love you, Lord Jesus. We thank you for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege and the opportunity that we have to honor you with our time, our commitment. Lord Jesus, we ask that your word would be inserted in not only us, but our children, our young people, our young adults, our Spanish-speaking congregants. That, Lord God, that we would see value in this, and that we would recognize and understand the journey, Lord, has to be made with you. And Lord, help us to learn about this secret place and that there's refuge in it. In Jesus' name, somebody say amen. 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 If you have spent any time in reading the Bible, and specifically the book of Psalms, it is a book of poetry. and it's read like poetry. And it's very important when we are reading the book of Psalms that we visualize the image that is being depicted. This is what this Psalms is written in, very descriptive way. And it all pertains to this descriptive poetry lines pertain to God. And so when we're reading this, we read it with the image of God in our life and the understanding of God in our life. And so the writer uses, probably we came up with these words later on, but the writer uses literary devices in which to bring about a stronger understanding and a recognition of who God is in our life. I think that you would agree to this. I want to know who God is, and I want to see Him for who He is, and I want to understand all of His attributes and characteristics as it relates to my walk with Him. And so the writer, Brother Mike, probably we've come up with these words later on, right? We've come up with a personification, anthropomorphism, zoomorphism. And so we later on, it's so much like humanity, right? To read something that God wrote, and then we come up with what it is. And then we become the smart people. But when we are looking at these literary devices that are used in order to promote who God is, personification, for example, is when human characteristics are used to create imagery for something that's not human. So the idea or the concept that we're reading about can be better understood. Personification, an example would be something like justice is blind. So we're using the understanding of justice. It's non-human, but we're using a characteristic, being blind, in order for us to understand the true value and the deeper understanding of the word justice. Right? Everybody got that? All right, you're like, wait a minute, I thought this was Bible study, not English class. Anthropomorphism is another one that is, say that to your neighbor, anthropomorphism. Anthropomorphism. Now spell it to them. Anthropomorphism, yes. What is anthropomorphism? It's basically when something non-human or not a full human is described as behaving as if it were human, right? So like an example would be you're speaking to somebody and anthropomorphism would be like, listen to your heart. Listen to your heart. So we're trying to really, really pull something that we understand into the reality of what we're trying to express. Zoomorphism is when an animal's characteristics is used to describe an object, a person, or for us, deity. The greatest example for our reading today would be found in verse number 4 of Psalms 91. It says, He, speaking of God, shall cover thee with His feathers. How many think God has feathers? Right? It's a literary device so that we can totally understand. We get this visual image. Under His wings shall you trust, and His truth shall be a shield and buckler, right? So it's pulling all of these understandings. And so the book of Psalms, when we're reading that, the book of Psalms uses all three of these literary devices quite often. And so as a reader, we it's, you know, I think it's important to be aware of these three concepts so that we appropriately understand the book of Psalms. We certainly don't want to pop open Psalms 91 and all of a sudden say, wow, I didn't know God was like a chicken. Oh my goodness. He's got feathers. All right. And then, you know, and he's got wings. So that's not what it is. But we very clearly and quickly get the image of care and concern, and we get the image of protection when we read that. And that's what we're trying to get. And so, like example in Psalms 91 and 1, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. We know that Colossians 1:15 and John chapter 4, verse 24 tells us that God is a spirit. He's invisible, right? So he can't cast a shadow. But we get the concept and we understand that we should be attentive to these hidden and personified language usage so that we get a clearer and larger understanding of God in our life. I mean, when we read that, we could read that and read it fast and not get it. When you read it slow and you start taking in the words, let me tell you something, when you're reading the Bible, it's not about getting done. It's about getting it in. And so that's very, very important. We don't want to just check a box and say, oh, I read my Bible today. If we didn't get anything out of it, then we need to go back and read it again. And so if we're not careful, we can pass over these and not understand them. And I'm going to tell you, when you're reading the Bible, God knows exactly where you are and what you're going through. And these kind of things will stand out and be like, man, this is why I feel the way I feel, and this is why I'm not feeling the way other people think I should be feeling. And so when we're talking about dwelling in a secret place or abiding under the shadow, what we're seeing is, man, we're living our life in position under God. The psalmist is telling us that his life was hidden from others because there was a sacred place where the psalmist would receive restoration and hope. And when you're reading this passage, you see stuff that you're being hidden from the wicked and under his wings and around his feathers and in his shadow And so the psalmist is trying to say, and he's trying to demonstrate the great need that we have for a secret place in our lives where we encounter God. He's trying to raise the level of value in our life to for us to understand there is a safe place, there is a harbor, there is a hiding place in which we can run to. And I just want to just tell somebody that God can be and God is a shelter that we can find rest in. He is that place. Excuse me. The psalmist, he uses buildings, right, to personify the protective qualities of God. The first 13 verses of Psalms 91 is spent assuring you and I that God will protect us from harm. Right? That's what he's doing. That he's assuring us that God will. He uses words like fortress. He uses words like refuge. He uses words like habitation. They're not identical. They're all places that a person might live and abide in. And this idea being personified here is that God's dwelling is not a place where an individual might go, but it's a place where an individual can live. He's talking about having a lifestyle of living in this place. That God is our shelter. I want to live in the shelter of God. I don't want to visit the shelter of God. Right? I don't want to visit it. I want to live in it. The psalmist also describes God as a hiding place. The idea of God being compared to a hiding place, or as one who hides the believer, is found in a bunch of psalms. Psalm 17, Psalms 27, Psalms 32, Psalms 64, Psalms 68, Psalms 119, the one that our passage today, always talks about God being our hiding place. And we understand that we're not in hiding in the human sense, but we are under Him, hidden in Him. And the idea is the association that we quickly link to protection. We quickly link to safety. When I'm in the hiding place of God, I'm protected. It's like we used to have a bigger pulpit than this, and it had three sides. You could actually get in it. You know, not the wooden one, but the plexiglass one. I don't know if you remember that one. And if we had it, I would get in it. There's nothing to get into here. Don't let that be your walk with God. But you could get in it, and it's not the idea of being hidden, because you could still see and be seen. But it's the idea of protection and the idea of safety, where we can live. And so He's our shelter. He is our hiding place. This is an expressive point that in times of trouble and times of uncertainty that we know where we live. And I certainly believe, and you believe, that in the day that we are in, I want to be in the hiding place of God. I want to be in the safety and the protection of God. And I don't mean just physical, although that's a part of it, but spiritually, I want to be in that hiding place. I want to walk above, and here we go. Now I'm using the words, right? Obviously we can't walk above, but we know what that means, walk above. Right? I want to rise above the situations in my life. I can't do that if I'm out by myself, but if I'm living hidden in Him. Hallelujah. And so the author goes on, and he moves from one literary device to another literary device, and he moves to zoomorphism by interjecting the idea of God's wings and His feathers, showing how they symbolize shelter in our life, under His feathers and under His wings. It gives us a concept of a mother bird providing for her young. And the idea of the young coming up underneath those wings and finding protection and care. Is anybody with me? Come on now. Amen. We have birds at our house. Oh, here he goes again, talking about the chickens. Goodness sakes. Yes, we have chickens. I don't know if you knew that. We have chickens. Sister Monique, we have one particular chicken.
It rises above.
They're all hens, right? We have no males. We have all females. And boy. Get eight females together. And so there's something innately positioned in male and female, right? God created us to have certain tendencies. And whereas males, there's this idea of protection, there's this idea of value and this idea of shelter. But females have a higher level of this understanding. Whatever, if you're offended by that, I'm sorry. But the fact of the matter is, my kids have never asked me for help in time of need. They've always gone to their mother. And I get offended. Oh, baby, you okay? You okay? Where's mommy? Mommy can't do any more than I can do. But you couldn't convince a child of that. No way. So we have one particular chicken right now. So it's in them, right? It's, and we have what's called a brooding chicken. It's a term. It's a condition. And when they lay, when I don't care who it is, whoever's laying eggs, well, not whoever, one of the other seven. We don't have random egg layers pop in the coop. The brooding chicken, there's this something on the inside of this hen that wants to protect those eggs and allow those eggs to go through the process of hatching. And so she will do away with eating and do away with drinking and do away with being with the other hens and being out of the nesting box. And we have to, she doesn't know they're not going to hatch. There's no rooster. Newsflash for some people. A hen will always produce an egg, but if there's no rooster, it's staying there. Okay, but she doesn't know that. And so this concept is seen in nature. We should understand this. Then I have to encourage her, and my wife, we have to encourage her. It's time to move on to the next thing in a day. Which they're big workers. They dig up everything, and it's time to move on. But she doesn't want to. She wants to protect those eggs. She wants to cover those eggs. She wants to. And man, I'm telling you what, and them eggs are hot when I get them. I'm thinking they're already scrambled on the inside. It's such a deal. And but we see these images of a mother bird using her wings to shelter her chicks and sheltering them from the elements or from predators. And so the psalmist is using this imagery, zoomorphism is what it's called, as God, as the protector who provides physical and emotional safety for the individual who is seeking protection. And if you've ever seen any clips or anything of chicks and chickens, and as you can imagine, I have. Ad nauseum. And the chicks will run. And the mother opens up her wings and covers them. This is what God does. And we need to see that and understand that. That he's not pushing us out, but he's inviting us in. He's not running from us, but running towards us. And when it feels like there's danger, he wants to provide that place of safety. And when there is the elements of life that are raining down and the wind is howling, he wants to provide that place of safety. So the psalmist is trying to bring us this imagery that we can understand and show us that God cares about us. And so he changes gears a little bit and says, how do I get into that? How do I ensure that I'm taking advantage of this great God, this great refuge, this great secret place? And it's simplistic. It really is. Walking with God and living for him is so simplistic. We're the ones that make it very hard. God's like, it's so easy. And we're like, no, it's hard. It's actually easy. And he gives us this concept that I'm going to hide myself in the Lord through my communication with him. I'm going to hide myself in the Lord, and that communication is called prayer. excuse me. And so prayer, we get to understand, is how the secret and the sacred place is created with the Almighty God. It's in that communication. Prayer, if you've ever spent any time in prayer, if you've been in a prayer meeting, if you've been with people that encourage prayer, you've enjoyed a time of prayer, and they probably are going to go have a time of prayer right now, actually. Grace, it's good to see you. Amen. Ramon, God bless you. You may not know what to say, but in that environment, you start feeling the results. That's why church is so important, to be around other people. It's so important to experience what maybe we're unfamiliar with, or maybe what we can't figure out how to get to. And so we learn by example, and we learn by the pulling of a group forward. And so I say to Christian Life Center that's why we have to provide that in our services. That we can't be ho-hum about it, because there's people that need to experience this refuge, this secret place, and maybe they've never experienced it, or they don't know how to experience it, and they would like to experience it. So when we're two rows in front, or we're two or three people to the left or to the right, and we begin to honor the Lord, and we begin to walk in that lifestyle of communicating with Him, it gives somebody an opportunity to say, that's the direction I want to go. And prayer becomes a place of freedom and liberation, where we can find the ability to express ourselves to God openly and honestly. And I just want to pause here and say that if you're new to our church, or you're visiting, or you're a guest or a friend, I want to tell you that prayer is one of the most vital instruments of our walk with God. And I don't mean prayer as in a prayer book where we recite and where we just by rote go through and have, I need a prayer on this, or I need a prayer on that. And I'm certainly not saying that we shouldn't read devotions and read things, but prayer is a conversation. And now I know a conversation, it feels like it should be two people talking. And when we first start praying, it feels like there's only one person talking. And it ain't God when we first start, right? Because it's new. We're learning how to hear His voice, and we're learning how to move into that secret place. And so I want to encourage you to have a conversation with the Lord. I want to encourage you. And everybody has conversations differently. And so don't worry about how your conversation is compared to about how somebody else's conversation is. I want you to have a conversation with God how you would have a conversation. Now, if you don't talk, that's a problem. That's not how you have a conversation. You got to talk. Turn to your neighbor and say, you got to talk. And so, yes, but Pastor, you don't understand. God knows my heart. Yes, He does. And He knows you're not talking. And so I want to encourage you, that is the pathway, that prayer becomes the pathway to the refuge of the secret place. And I want you to know, you can trust God. You can trust Him. How many are, when you're work, you're sitting down, how many when you're working the Monday through whatever it is that you're sitting down? How many work? There we go. We got to start there. Does anybody use a chair? All right. I got to figure out how to ask the questions correctly. And you spend hours and hours in the chair, right? And if you have a smartwatch, the smartwatch tells you that you need to get up. And walk around and stretch and then, you know. So you spend hours in the chairs. Why? Why do you spend hours in the chair? You don't even think about this. You don't even think about this. But you trust the chair. Right? I mean, you don't even think about it. It's not even a thought. Now, you may not like the chair, but you trust it. It may be a little uncomfortable, but you trust it. If you didn't trust in the chair, then you probably wouldn't sit down in the chair. Right? So whatever we trust in is where we're going to place our lives. I want you to think about that just for a second. And make sure that connects. Where you place your lives tells you a lot about where you place your trust. And if you work that backwards, do you really trust where you're placing your life? I want you to know that God is a place that you can run to and you can trust. You can trust Him. For people that talk about God not being real, and certainly we understand that He's a spirit, and that they have the most difficult time trusting in something that they say is so mean, but yet doesn't have any abilities in their mind. It's a very convoluted thing, which lets me know that they actually do believe. They actually do believe. And maybe they got trust issues. Maybe you have trust issues. Maybe you've been taken advantage of. Maybe you're a little gun shy. Maybe you're a little skittish. I want you to know that you're surrounded by people here today that can testify that God has never taken advantage of them. And God has never let them down. And God has never forced Himself upon anyone. And we can trust Him. And we can place our life in Him and into His care. The Bible tells us that God has pledged His compassion and pledged His righteousness to us. And without going into a long theological dissertation here, but He has pledged that through the cross. That act of going to the cross, of God robing Himself in flesh and dwelling among us and then taking the journey to the cross, that is the pledge to us. And He demonstrated that He would execute judgment upon sin, while also extending mercy and love to sinners. In Romans chapter 3, we see this. How do we see this? God, the Bible says, in 2 Corinthians 5, reconciling the world to Himself. God has proven Himself trustworthy. He desires to eradicate sin while saving the sinner. And He's faithful. Somebody say He's faithful. If you love the Lord, His faithfulness is tangible. It's tangible. You can feel the faithfulness of God. When you communicate with Him and you love Him and you place your life in Him and you hide yourself in Him and you allow yourself to be a part of Him, He is faithful. He's faithful. In the first part of our text in Psalms, the psalmist is speaking to a person who is seeking God's care and protection. And so he goes through 13 verses of explaining and bringing understanding. In the last three verses of Psalms 91, God speaks to this individual. He speaks to this individual. in verse number 14, the last three verses, he says, because he hath set his love upon me, speaking to the individual, therefore I will deliver him. And I will set him on high because he hath known my name. Speaking to the about the individual, he shall call upon me and I will answer him. And I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. Speaking to the individual about the individual, he says, and with long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Hallelujah. Not only did the psalmist spend time describing how God protects, cares for, but the psalmist features God pledging himself to the protection and the deliverance of those who trust in the Lord. And I know that just through the testimonies that I've heard throughout this congregation that at different times and in different ways, God's faithfulness is seen in the lives of those who trust in Him. His faithfulness is seen. Sister Uni, it is so good to see you. Why did you all clap? You're happy for me to see her? Oh, you're happy to see her too? Okay. Sister Uni has just been on a journey. Oh, my Lord, have mercy. I almost made some phone calls. To who? I have no idea. She is in a journey. She had to check out of her hotel. She had to go stay with somebody that she just met on the job. I mean, she had her passport taken from her. I mean, it was just a mess. It was a mess. But God is faithful, isn't He? To those who put their trust in Him, He will deliver them. He will keep them. Under His wings and His feathers does He hide you. Hallelujah. She's in a very unsafe country on her job, but the Lord gave her provision to be in a very protected area when she had to be on her own, to say the least, right? To say the least. And there's so much to the story. And thank the Lord that He, when you set your love upon Him, that He delivers. He delivers because you know His name, Sister Uni. If there's anybody in this room that knows His name, I know Sister Uni knows His name, but there's a lot more people in this room that know His name. Does anybody know His name? And so because we have this understanding, now I can trust in God. It's important for us to hear stuff like the testimonies of God's provision and God's protection and God's care in our life. It's important because then when we're in that same situation, we're like, oh, wait a minute, hold on a second. I know, I've heard this before. And God did it for them. And if God did it for them, then God can do it for me. And I'm not going to run from God. I'm going to stay right here in this protection. I'm feeling a little overwhelmed, but I need to know that I'm in the shelter and the refuge of the secret place. Now, I know that when you go to work tomorrow and you sit down in that chair, you're not going to think anything about that chair. Because you have come to live a lifestyle of trust in that chair. Now, if you had come from an environment or a life and lived where there was no chairs, and you sat on the ground, which some cultures do, and somebody said, why don't you sit in this chair? It would be challenging. Now, this is a hard concept because you just can't even think about not sitting in a chair. And I'm going to tell you, thinking about sitting on the ground and getting up again is a super hard concept. But it's such a very concrete idea that we don't even consider it. Now, we even complain about it sometimes. Right? Do we? You're going to have to change this chair. I got a little thing going on back here. This thing needs to be changed. I know the unspoken. But we hand our life over to this chair. I'll never forget my dad. We were overseas, and you ever seen those white plastic chairs with plastic legs? And we were in an area that was extremely hot. And I think those chairs were being subjected to the heat. Right? I mean, even when we sat down on them, we were like, "Ah, oh." And my poor dad, it could have been any of us. It just happened to be him. He sat down on that chair, and some of them back legs. You ever seen that? Yeah. I mean, it was like a super slow motion. I mean, he knew it was happening. We knew it was happening. And nobody can move. We just watched. Man, why? Look at that. Oh, my goodness. Ah. And it wasn't until he got on the ground that we all like, oh, hey, whoa, whoa. Like, why couldn't we help him before? I don't know. But I tell you what, for the rest of that trip, it was hilarious. It would be like, all right, let's see. Okay, yeah. Now we're not going to do that. I mean, we would chow out every chair there was in wherever we were. We weren't going to have that happen again. But normally we trust, right? And I get it. Handing what we would consider handing our entire life to an invisible God can seem a bit abstract if it's new. It can seem a bit abstract. But there's this value in trusting God. And understanding that not only is He, but He wants to be. He wants to be our refuge. Our refuge. I would love to have the time to spend on God instituted in the Old Testament, and I want to develop this a little bit more, but God instituted in the Old Testament 6 cities of refuge. And what they were to function as places of asylum or safety for unintentional taking of life. It was the unintentional taking of life. There were 6 cities set up across the area. And if you unintentionally took a life in the Old Testament and you could get to one of those cities, then you would have refuge. And God provided these cities because He was the legal system of that day. He recognized that there needed to be some protection and some legality of care and concern. And the concept of these cities of refuge in the scriptures really should remind us and remind when we're reading that God is concerned about us. The accidental things that happen in our life, the stumblings that happen in our life, God's concerned about that. God's not ready to come in and beat you up with a baseball bat because you stumbled and you fell into a pit and you accidentally got involved with something. He wants you to know that he cares about you and that he has provided a place of refuge where you can experience not only protection, but healing and deliverance. And God will protect you. Turn to your neighbor and say, he'll protect you. God shows us that in the life of Paul in the book of Acts, specifically chapter 21 and through 28. Paul, who was Saul, did an amazing job of trying to eradicate Christianity. And then God did an amazing job when Paul was arresting people. God arrested Paul, or Saul, and changed his name to Paul. And God protected Paul through that transition. Can you imagine that type of transition? You know that coworker who's always nasty? And you do? That coworker who's always berating, and the family member who's always making fun of you, and the community person who's always, you know what I'm saying? And it's just like, man, leave me alone. I'll leave you alone if you leave me alone. Right? That person, it's kind of like Saul, and then they leave you on Friday, let air out of your tire because you were parking in the employee of the month parking spot, and they were jealous, and they bad-mouthed you to the boss, and then they come in on Monday and they're handing you coffee and donuts. Do you trust that? This is what happened with Saul. He went to one house on Friday and he arrested everybody. And then he went to the next house on Monday and he wanted to pray with everybody. And so you can imagine sort of the transition and the experiences that he had. And then not only that, he gets arrested by the same people that he was working for. And he went through a whole process of appealing and testifying, and then he was placed in a ship, and he had to be taken to Rome, and he experienced shipwreck and the miraculous protection of God, and he was on house arrest for 2 years, and all that was going on in his life, and he set out on a journey to make Jesus known to the world. And God protected him every step of the way. And we read that verse, and he was shipwrecked, and he was beaten, and he was, I mean, just on and on and on. And he said not only was it from those that without, but it was from those from within too. And so God not only protects you, but he'll deliver you, and God will be with you in times of trouble. God intentionally entered into the midst of our troubles. He robed himself in flesh and he dwelt among us. He intentionally inserted himself in the same life that we live. He understands it. He understands the disappointments, and he understands the difficulties. He understands the challenges. And he did this so that he might walk alongside us and that we might trust him. Hebrews chapter 1 tells us, God, who at sundry times in diverse manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these days spoken to us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. This is the journey by which he joins us. And instead of sending somebody else, he sent himself to model for us this relationship. And Jesus, God robed in flesh, entered into life's difficulties by embracing the fragility of life and fully experiencing the brokenness of our world. And so for you and I, we can trust that. We can read it, we can take it in, and then we can live it. When we read it, we live it, it gives us the opportunity to trust it. I want to encourage every one of us today to live out this refuge of a secret place in your life. I want you to live out this relational peace in your life. I want you to live out the protection of God in your life. I want you to live out this idea of trusting and honoring the Lord Jesus Christ. Can somebody say amen? We can never be too busy to pray, because prayer changes everything. A conversation changes everything. A conversation, it does away with misunderstandings, conversation does. A conversation brings clarity. A conversation brings understanding. A conversation brings education. A conversation brings peace and hope and joy. Conversation. And if all that happens when we converse with each other, what happens when we have a conversation with God? It brings about all of the attributes that we desire in our life. And I want to encourage us this morning to, as we read the scriptures and as we are going through our devotionals, 1.2 starts tomorrow, our devotionals, to read it through the lens of God being our refuge. And that secret place of devotion and prayer brings us in the safety and the protection and the care of God in our life. I and you do not want to walk through this life without Him. I nor you want to walk in this life without Him. And so we need to be in Him. Somebody say, I need to be in Him. In Jesus' name. Let's stand. I want you to grab the hand of the person that's next to you and let's pray one for another that we might find that secret place in the Lord, in Jesus' name. We love you, Lord Jesus. We thank you for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you, Lord God, for your help and your care. We thank you, Lord, for your protection, your refuge in time of need. We ask, Lord Jesus, that you would help us as we learn to trust in you and we learn, God, to live our life in you, that, God, that you would make yourself known to us and that we would feel that evidence in our life and that, God, would propel us one more level in that trust, that, God, we would feel your wings and your feathers, your protection, Lord Jesus, that we would feel, God, the refuge and the shelter and the strength that comes from you. I thank you for it, God. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody say amen. 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 God bless you. As we move into our transition, if you have children that are in Kids Zone, please make your way there. And if you have young people, that they probably will make their way to you. But please feel free to get them. Amen. And in about 5 minutes, we will begin our worship service. I thank you for being here today in our Church Plus. God bless you.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord. Oh, we come to lift his name up in this place. We come to exalt the great God of heaven. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We're going to sing the doctrine.
One, two, check, one, two.
We're going to sing the doctrine we preach and we live. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes, Lord Jesus. We're going to celebrate. Yes. We're going to celebrate this great God. Hallelujah. Oh, bless me in this place this morning. Ah, we glorify the great God of heaven. Our great God and our Savior. Yes, He is. Yes, Lord. Wonderful, wonderful. Jesus is to me Counselor, Prince of Peace, Mighty God is He, saving me, keeping me from all sin and shame. Wonderful is my Redeemer, praise His name. Wonderful,
wonderful, wonderful.
Well, Jesus is to me
Counselor, Prince of Peace, the Mighty God is He,
and is saving me and keeping me
from all sin and shame. Wonderful is my Redeemer, praise His name.
Wonderful,
wonderful, wonderful, Jesus is to me Counselor, Prince of Peace, Mighty God is He,
and is saving me and keeping me
from all sin and shame. Wonderful is my Redeemer, praise His name.
I want to thank God
for the blood.
Prophets, He is El Shaddai. Of all those seers and sages, He's the mighty one. Upon those sacred pages, He's the great I am. Come on, sing
it. The great I am.
Everlasting Father.
Everlasting Father.
Well, He's the Prince. Body baptized with the Holy Ghost. Oh, there is just one way to enter it, just like they did it at Pentecost. Well, are you in the church? Baptized with the Holy Ghost. There is just one way to enter in it, just like they did it at Pentecost. Well, are you in the church
triumphant?
Tell me, are you in it?
Are you in the Savior's bride?
Come and be baptized.
of one way. All men is loving the one way. All men is walking in the one way. Standing in the one way. Embracing the one way. Oh yes, Lord. Because the mighty God is Jesus. The Prince of Peace is He. The everlasting Father. And King eternally. More wonderful in wisdom. By whom all things were made. All the fullness of the Godhead in Jesus is displayed.
It's born in Him.
I tell you,
it's born in Him.
All
the fullness of the Godhead. It's born in Him.
I tell you,
it's born in Him.
It's born in Him.
It's born in Him. The mighty God is Jesus. And it's born in Him.
Emmanuel, God is with us. In Him.
Your salvation is in a safe place. Your salvation is that in that covering place our pastor was just talking about this morning. Your salvation is secure in God. But you got to live there in that secure place. You got to make that disclosure. No eternal security. Amen. Praise God. I agree. Bless the name of Jesus.
You are the risen King.
you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. How many could just say hallelujah? Thank the Lord. We thank the Lord for who He is. We thank the Lord for His provision in our life. We thank the Lord for His authority and His power. We thank the Lord for His forgiveness, His mercy, and His grace. I wonder if just one time we could give the Lord a hand praise of thanksgiving. Amen. You may be seated. We want to bring our concerns and our prayers to the Lord today, asking God to help us, encourage us, bless us, walk beside us. As I said earlier in our Church Plus session, it's good to see Sister Uni home from her trip. Amen. Amen. She's thanking the Lord. Amen. Amen. And I see some others there that are thanking the Lord. Amen. She had a tough time getting back to the States, but we're thanking God for His care and provision and walk with her. Amen. Sister Denora Dominguez is thanking the Lord. She gave a sacrificial offering, and there's something before prayer. That's always a good word before prayer. Answered. She gave a sacrificial offering, answered prayer, and provision. She was believing in God for a very special situation. God's not a vending machine, okay? But when we put our faith and trust in Him, we do that through tangible means. So we do it with our time, we do it with our talent, we do it with our finances, we do it with our commitment, we do it with Him. And she's thanking the Lord that the Lord worked out everything and actually returned her offering 100 times, hallelujah, to the Lord. Amen. Thanking God for that. Amen. Sister Deborah and Brother John King, thanking CLC for your prayers and care and thoughtfulness towards them during their time of loss. And we want to continue to pray for that family, as they will always have to handle the burden and the transition of death. And we thank the Lord that the church family is in existence so that we can lean on each other in time of need. Amen? Amen. We want to go to the Lord in prayer with our needs. And if we have a stack of prayer needs here today, and God knows exactly what needs to happen in each and every one of our lives. And if you're here today and you have a prayer need in your life, we want to join you and pray with you. Amen. Sister Rebecca had some blood work come back that's not in a positive direction, and we need God to intervene. Sister Jennifer Johnson is praying for Sandra, who lost her mother in this time of transition. We want to pray for the Goodwin and Wood families, as they have also suffered loss and death in their family. Brother Larry and Sister Joyce Elliott, both their daughters' families are suffering with sickness. We want to pray for Sister Ashley. Their daughters are sick, and Sister Trishelle is very, very sick. I thought I saw Andre Clark. Did I see Andre today? Maybe they're still suffering from sickness. Their family, the Clark family, is suffering from sickness, and we want God to touch them. Sister Donka is praying for, is this a co-worker or a friend? Co-worker in needs of healing, really is come to the final stages of cancer, and we want God to touch and heal, but also be present. We want Him to be present and allow Sister Robinson to be that conduit of God's grace and presence. And it's good to see the Broadnecks families back from being overseas also. thankful for God's protection and provision in their life. Amen. But Brother Lonnie is dealing with some challenges that looks like will require surgery. And we want God to heal him, his shoulder area. So if you do pray for him, don't lay hands on his shoulder, at least not the one that is in pain. Amen. And so he's got some stuff going on there that will require surgery. We want God to heal him. God can heal that. He can heal anything. He can take care of all this stuff. Amen. But the result of healing, as we look through the scripture, the result of miracles and healing is so that his name would be glorified, that he would be made known and revealed unto men. So, Lord, we recognize and understand that when we bring our needs to you, we want you to be glorified. We want you to be recognized. And we want our life to be more stable and secure in you, and that others might see you through that. Amen? Amen. Just across the audience on this side starting, if you have a prayer need and you didn't get a chance to put a request in, just lift your hands and just we want to identify who you are. Amen there. How about this section here? Just lift your hands if you have a prayer need. Amen. How about this section here? And this goes all the way to the riser. Sorry. I apologize. Amen. Right here. And how about this section over here, prayer need? Amen. All right. Well, why don't we all stand? Why don't we all stand? And if you saw someone that had their hand raised, you could join them and pray with them or point your hands towards them. We've mentioned quite a few prayer needs here verbally, but we have quite a few that is in our audience too. And if you're online, we encourage you to type in your prayer need in Facebook chat or YouTube chat, and we will add that to our list of prayers. And why don't we join together as a body of Christ, and let's pray one for another that God would help and provide in Jesus' name. We love you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, God, for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your help in time of need. Lord God, you see all the needs that are represented here in this congregation, online, Lord, and those that we have read aloud. We ask, Lord God, that you would help, that you would make a way. We're asking, Lord Jesus, that you would touch Brother Lonnie, Lord God. The Lord, that you would heal his body, Lord Jesus. We're asking, Lord, that you would touch Bonnie Yen, Lord God. Lord, that your grace and your mercy, God, would be extended to her. And Lord, that Sister Robinson would be that conduit of peace and grace. We thank you, Lord, for touching the Clark family, Lord Jesus. God, I ask you to touch Trishelle and Ashley's families, Lord, and them as individuals, God. As, Lord, they are dealing with this challenging time, we ask, Lord, that you would surround them, Lord Jesus. We ask, Lord God, that you would surround the Goodwin and the Wood family, Lord Jesus. The Hilton family, Lord God, that you would surround them. Ask that, God, that you would provide provisional healing. Provide healing, Lord Jesus, for Rebecca, Lord Jesus. That, God, that she would sense and understand and recognize your love and care for her as only you can, Lord God. I thank you for it, Jesus. Lord, those needs that are in the audience, Lord, we're praying and we're binding together, believing in your faithfulness as we honor you, Lord God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your help and your grace and mercy and your strength, Lord God. I ask, God, that you administer that to our congregation, to our guests, our friends, Lord Jesus. We thank you for it, God, in Jesus' name. And you'll be quick, God, to get the glory. We, Lord, will honor you, Lord, in our victories, Lord Jesus. Recognizing, understand that without you, it's impossible to do anything. But through you, Lord, we can. We can. So we put ourselves in you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I thank you, Lord God. I thank you, Lord. Amen. If you receive that prayer and you believe God's able to do it, why don't you give him a big hand of praise, of thanksgiving? Thank you, Lord God. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. And what a great day it is. This is our second week in Church Plus, and I thank you for being faithful to that. And we only have 6 more weeks to go in this time of focused education in the Word of the Lord to the different environments, age demographics in our congregation. I want to remind you that we're doing our best We only have an hour with your children, your young people, young adults, our Spanish-speaking and our adults. And we ask you to do your best to be on time so that we can facilitate that in their life. Very much so, we want to do that. I want to remind you that tomorrow starts 2.1 in our devotion, 2.1 in our daily devotion. And you'll notice that with Church Plus, we actually launch the devotions on Sunday mornings. And so that's one of the benefits of Church Plus. Now your reading throughout the rest of the week is going to come from the launching ground of Sunday morning. And so if you don't have a book, a Chris Titus book, then you need to get that. Oh, you're not Chris Titus. Where is Chris Titus? Oh, there you go. Come here, Brother Chris. I know this is a big pain in the neck. This is just fun. Just turn his lights on down here as much as you can. Yeah, we need to. This is our. Can we get that on the big? Oh yeah, we can get that on the big screen. Yeah, the Chris Titus book. This is the. Isn't that wonderful? Look at that. Isn't that? I need you to turn sideways and put your head just down a little bit. Just down. Yeah, put your chin down. There you go. Now cry. I need you to cry. There's a tear on there. Amen. I love Brother Chris Titus. Yes. Amen. If you get your book, he'll sign it after the service. Amen. And $50. Oh, man. Oh, my goodness. Going to missions. Amen. If you don't get a chance to get a book, then on our website, clceast.org, at the bottom of the front page is a downloadable PDF for you to take advantage of that, and the PDF for our youth and our children. Amen. And our children, if you're in pre-K through sixth grade, say amen. 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 Say amen. 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 We're going to prepare ourselves for our morning tithe and offering. So as you're preparing for that, our children are traveling through the Bible, and they are traveling to, I'm going to do it now. Traveling through, you guys can come on. Yeah, come on. Traveling through the Bible, and they are going to modern day countries and cities and showing them through the Bible where that is. And so today, let's see. We'll ask your children. Let's see. Maya? Mia. And Emma? Okay, did you guys go to Church Plus today? Sunday school? I know I'm totally putting you on the spot. And I am so sorry. Do you know what country you went to today?
Yes, we went to Egypt.
You went to Egypt. All right. Oh, yes. Yes. Amen. They went to Egypt today. And they had a great time. And let's go see what everybody else is doing. Hallelujah. Come on. Yes, 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 yes. What's up, Dwight? Good to see you, buddy. Amen. Well, let's see who's in the foyer today. Just kidding. Just kidding. Just kidding. Yeah. Oh, sorry. Yep. Okay. Once again, remember, Church Plus, for the next six Sundays, this would be, if we had seven, this would be number seven, but there's only six left. And you come into the foyer and time of fellowship and greeting everyone. And our children and our youth and our Spanish speaking go this way. And so we go this way. Yes. We go this way. And we come down the hallway. Am I going too fast? Okay, all right. We come down the hallway, and they're around in the corner. Yes. Oh, there's Egypt. Brother Sanjeev. That's a good Egyptian name. That's Heaven Bound Airlines. There it is right there. Heavenbound. This is where the children, pre-K through sixth grade. We already did that last week. But if you keep on coming down, you go into our youth area, which is our seventh through 12th graders, and you come in to our youth area, and this is what you're going to be invited with, our greeters right here, all of our greeters, and then you come over, you can have a time of fellowship and snacks, yes, good old donuts, and some good orange juice. Nobody had any orange juice today, it's completely full, right? And then you could hang out here, have a little time of fellowship, some games, some group games, and hey, there's Brother Lettman right there, one of our youth leaders. Who's with me? Yeah. Okay, and Brother Justin, and this is our youth room where our youth meet every single Sunday morning during Church Plus. They also meet here every Wednesday night for our youth service. You don't want to miss it. If you have a young person in 7th through 12th grade, you want to make sure that they are here on Church Plus Sunday mornings and on Wednesday nights. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Give the Lord a hand praise if you're excited about Church Plus. Amen. There's no service tonight. There's no ministry tonight. And we had a fabulous time over the last couple days at our Maryland DC District GO Conference. Thursday night, Friday night, and Saturday was fabulous. We canceled our midweek service to give everybody an opportunity to be at those services on Thursday night and Friday. If you did not get an opportunity, if you're a member here at Christian Life Center and you didn't come Thursday or Friday night, you missed it. Shame on you. You missed it. You should have been here. You have an opportunity. You can look on YouTube at the Maryland DC District YouTube page and or their Facebook page, and you can access those services. I really encourage you to view Thursday night, Friday night, and Saturday afternoon, but Friday and Saturday was fabulous. Everything was fabulous. I really want you to view that. Amen. So no services tonight. Over the next 2 months, in our young adults and our youth and our children, there is a lot of announcements and activities that are coming up. This Friday night, the young adults will have a game night in the foyer. This Saturday, there's a youth trip, a kids zone parents trip. Next Sunday is men's ministry night right here, Brother Jim. It's a competition, isn't it? It's a competition. And do you gotta sign up or do you just show up? Gotta be here at 6 o'clock next Sunday night for the competition, the cornhole competition. The cornhole competition. Oh yeah, and just for everybody to know, Brother Luke is back from Europe. Yes, Luke is back. Right, Luke? Are you back? And you're out of practice, and so we're all excited about that. Amen. And so we're going to have a good time that next Sunday, and then, of course, that Monday is men's prayer night at 8 p.m. Let's all stand. The Lord is good to us. We're thankful. I'm thankful for all of our staff that's all throughout the building during Church Plus that is accommodating all of our age demographics and putting the word of the Lord into each and every person. Amen. We're going to receive our morning tithe and offering. If you'll turn to your right, our ushers will guide us row by row. You'll just make a circle, come out of your row, make a circle back to the other side of the row. Our risers, they have those accommodations for you. And as our musicians play, our ushers guide you. Why don't you come and give to the Lord, and then we'll pray over it in Jesus' name. gave something in the offering, you've given online, you want to be a part of God's blessing, stretch your hands forth. Let's pray in Jesus' name. We love you, Lord Jesus. We thank you for your goodness and mercy. We ask, Lord God, that you'd bless the giver. We ask, Lord, you'd bless their homes, their families, their places of employment. In Jesus' name we pray. We love you, and everybody say amen. Everybody say amen. Somebody shout unto the Lord with a loud voice. Somebody shout unto the Lord with a loud voice. Here we go.
Wandering into the night, wanting a place to hide this weary soul. This whole bag of bones, yes. Now I try with all my might, but I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting like a vagabond. And just when I ran out of road, I met a man I didn't know. And he told me I'm not alone.
Get up, get up, get up.
Church today. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. The book of Revelation, the Bible says that, behold, I come quickly. So get your Bibles quickly. The one verse of scripture, I'm certainly cognizant of the time, probably more than you are. Nah, that ain't right. Proverbs chapter 18, verse number 24. Don't sit down just because we're going into another part of the service, okay? And I can't even make my own joke. Personification-wise, don't sit down just because we're going to the next service. And don't be sitting on your wings. You had to be in Church Plus for that joke to even make any sense. Proverbs 18 and 24, the Bible says, a man hath friends, must show himself friendly. Now, this is the part I want you to read out loud. And there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. I want you to know that there is a friend. Turn to your neighbor and say, there is a friend. And I want you to know his name is Jesus Christ. And that he wants to be with you around you, in you. He wants to be everything to you. Can somebody say amen? Give the Lord a hand praise if you believe that he wants that. And if you want it, give him a hand praise. Hallelujah. There is a friend. There is a friend. God bless you. You may be seated. I think I heard that Brother Sean and Sister Wendy and Zanders is here. Where are y'all? Oh, okay. There we go. Hallelujah. Right back here is Keyshawn and Azaniah with you. They're spread out all over. Amen. God bless you all. They transitioned to the West Coast. Amen. They're here for a visit. We're certainly glad that they're here. It's good to see. I just literally almost made a joke. It's good to see Vicky and Chris, but they're not there. That was the joke. Chris and Sarah Blasek here. This is Vicky Peterson's sister. Amen. And brother-in-law. And is that Oliver? That's Oliver. And Kit is out with Vicky. Aunt Vicky. Amen. Glad to see you all there. Amen. And it's good to be in the house of the Lord today, isn't it? And I want you to know we live in a crazy world. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's crazy, 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 crazy. Life is broken. Don't you know that? We are living in a broken world. And we are, it doesn't matter if you listen to the radio, if you're reading your news blogs, if you're in conversation, there doesn't seem to be a lot of good news lately, does there? Doesn't seem to be a lot of good news, and it seems like the daily grind can get to the point where it's slowing us down and it's beating us up. The Bible tells us of the day in which we're living that the devil... Well, he won't be tempting us and putting sin in front of us as much as he will try to wear us down. Wear us down. We almost understand his tactics, and so he switches up. The Bible says in the last days he'll wear out the saints of the Most High. Let's be honest with ourselves. How many feel worn out? Amen. It's just the way it is. We often long for the old days. We don't even know what they are, but we often long for them. Do we really long for them? No water, no air, no indoor plumbing. Do we really long for them? We don't long for them. Farming all day long. No, we enjoy. But the devil understands that if he can wear us down, the devil understands if he can get us exhausted, that we got nothing left to give to God because we've given everything to life. But life is broken, and we need to have that place of refuge that we talked about today. We need to have that place of shelter that we talked about today. We need to have that place that we can find provision and find safety, and we can find solace in this broken world that we are living. It seems like maybe the only answer, and many people have unfortunately come to this conclusion, is that the only way that we can get around this kind of pressure and the only way that we can get out from underneath this kind of oppression is to get off or to get out of the world. And maybe ultimately that is true, that as a Christian we know that ultimately when that trumpet sounds that we will be relieved from the pressure of this life. But I want you to know the enemy is trying so hard and so desperate to put so much pressure on individuals that they would desire to take their own life and desire to end everything. And that's not the answer. What we really need and what each of us really need is to ensure the friendship that we have with our Savior, to make sure that we've got that place that we can run to, that one that we can call upon, that one that will always have an ear to hear and always be present when we need them. What we need is a friend. Turn to your neighbor and say, you need a friend. Hallelujah. You don't need another job. You need a friend. You don't need more money. You need a friend. You don't need another relationship. You need a friend. You don't need all the material things of the world. You need a friend. Somebody say, I need a friend. I need a friend. I need a strong friend.
I need a reliable friend. I need a friend that's never going to leave me. I need a friend that's never going to forsake me. I need a friend that can actually bear the weight of my burdens in my life. I want to tell somebody that if you don't know Jesus Christ as the Savior of your life, then you've never really understood Him as a friend. And He wants to be a friend. He doesn't want to just lord over you. He wants to walk beside you. He doesn't want to just command you. He wants to talk with you. He doesn't want to suppress you. He wants to lift you. And as we talked about this morning, He wants to walk with me. That's what reminds me of that old song that we used to sing as a kid. Oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. Hallelujah. Is anybody in the building can say, I have that friend. Hallelujah. I have that friend. If you're finding yourself in this day in which we're living, if you're finding yourself in this broken world and the pressure seems to be getting too great, if you find yourself going through the daily grind and you're wondering, is there ever any end to it? I want you to know there is a place that you can go to. There is a friend that you can have. There is encouragement that you can receive. There is power that you can live in. You may have a friend in your life, but I want you to know, as good of a friend as you have, they're not available to you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days of a year. You might have a friend that has a good ear, but they gotta do other things in their life. I want you to know that Jesus Christ wants to be present in your life, available in your life, and provider in your life. It doesn't matter what time in the morning it is or what time in the evening it is. It doesn't matter what day it is. It doesn't matter if you're on vacation, if you're in work, out of work. It doesn't matter if you're in your house or out of your house. It doesn't matter. Jesus Christ is available every single moment that you need Him. He's not only a friend, He's a big friend. He's not only a big friend, He's a powerful friend. He's not only a powerful friend, He's a competent friend. I want you to know that God wants to be with you on the battlefields of your life, through the difficulties that you manage, through the struggles that you go with, through the victories that you experience, the mountaintops and the valleys. I want to have a friend that sticketh closer to me than any brother that I've ever had. Anybody experience pain in your life? I don't want to be by myself experiencing pain. I don't want to be weighted down with tension all by myself. I don't want to be frustrated on every side and not have any kind of relief in my life. The Bible tells us that God wants to be involved in your world, in my world. And I want to tell you this morning, in the short time that we have, that it's a promise that you can count on. When you give your life to Jesus Christ and you trust in Him and you allow Him to enter in through the infilling of the Holy Ghost and you're baptized in Jesus' name, you got a friendship that'll take you through the thick and through the thin, through the highs and through the lows, and will take you right out of this world to eternity to live with Him forever and ever. The Bible reminds us in the book of Psalms, chapter 113, and verse number 5, the Bible says, who is like unto the Lord our God? And who dwelleth on high? Who humbleth himself to behold the things that are in heaven and in earth? He raiseth up the poor out of the dust. He lifteth up the needy out of the dunghill. Boy, that's a bad place to be. There he may set him with princes, even with the princes of his people. Can anybody witness and tell me that, yes, I was living life on a downward trajectory, but when I met Jesus Christ, he lifted me up and he picked me up. Yes, it was this as if I was living on a dunghill, but Jesus Christ set me up and he set me up with princes, even princes of my own people. Can I get a witness in here today? today that Jesus Christ is the best friend that you can ever have. Jesus' arm is not short that he cannot reach every single person as to where they are. He'll reach down as far as he's got to go. He'll go to the dirt. He'll go to the garbage dump. He'll go to the dunghill, and he will befriend the friendless. Hallelujah. And he'll pick you up and turn you around and place your feet on solid ground, as the song says. But he's more than capable of just picking you up and I up. The Bible gives us the indication that not only can he pick us up, but he can dust us off. And not only can he dust us off, but he can set us on solid ground. Hallelujah. I'm thankful that Jesus Christ has the ability and he has the strength to deliver me in my time of need. And I want you to know that he can do that for each and every one of us today. Our time of need. God wants to start you on a journey. He wants to join you on your journey. He wants to continue with you on your journey. Whatever it may be, God wants to be a part of your life every single day. He declared in Exodus chapter 3, he says, "And I am come down," and I want you to read the next four words with me. "I have come down to deliver them out." Is the board jumping around? Is that what's going on? Okay. "To deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians." And then read it with me. "And to bring them up out of that land into a good land. And a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto a place of the Canaanites and Hittites and Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites." But the point is, that first part, I've come to deliver them out so that I can bring them up. I want you to know that's exactly what Jesus Christ wants to do to each and every person in this room. He wants to come into your life so he can deliver you and I out, and so that he can bring us up with him. He does not want to leave you exactly where you are. He wants to bring you into a better place than you've ever been. Hallelujah. And he wants you to know that he's not going to leave you, nor is he going to forsake you. As Matthew 28, 20 tells us, "Teaching them to observe all things whichsoever I've commanded you, and let you understand that I am with you always." Somebody say always. "Even unto the end of the world." What is the promises of God? The promises of God are that I'm not going to leave you, I'm not going to forsake you, that I'm going to bring you out so I can bring you up, and I'm not going to do anything but help you get to a better place in your life. The Bible says in Job, Job says that a man born of a woman, days are full of trouble. I don't care how hard our culture tries to do it. You're only going to be born of a woman. Fact number one. Fact number one. Fact number two is, you're going to have a lot of trouble. So the Bible promises that a man born of a woman's days are full of trouble. Life is going to have its pain. The Bible says it rains on the just and the unjust. We don't live in the Garden of Eden. We live in a sin-drenched world, and as a result of that, we are subjected to the results of sin in the world in which we live. And we are subjected to that result also in our own life if we participate in sin. And so life and around life can be full of pain. Turn to your neighbor and say, "You can count on that." Oh, that's encouraging. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you for that encouraging word. Turn to your neighbor and say, well, hopefully your neighbor is not the pain. Hopefully that's what it is. Hopefully. It's the nature of things in this sin-stained world in which we live. It's the way it is when sin entered into the world, it broke that connection of perfection. It broke that bond between humanity and deity. And so we strive to retain that, and we should be striving to get that back again. But we don't. It's God, though, that's striving to regain that. Thank you, Lord, for not giving up on us. Thank you, Lord, for always reaching for us. Thank you, Lord, for reaching for us through our family. Thank you, Lord, for reaching for us through our friends. Thank you, Lord, for reaching for us through circumstances. Thank you, Lord, for reaching for us through the pain that we suffer in our life, through a song that's sung, through a message that's preached, through a sign that I see, Lord God. Thank you for always reaching for us. I want to reach for God as much as He's reaching for me. Hallelujah. That's the kind of life that I want to live. But we live in this sin-stained planet. And the only hope that we have is in and of God. He says, I will be with you always. I want somebody to hold up your hands and have them in fists. This is what living life is like, not in an angry but in a tension way. This is what living life in this world is like. And some of us, we curl into ourselves. Some of us, we need to have the proverbial weighted blanket on us to feel something. We feel that, but I want you to know that when we hear words like "and I will be with you always," I will never leave you nor forsake you. That in a spiritual sense, that tension should start to be relieved from us. It doesn't happen automatically. It doesn't happen in an instant. It happens as we develop that understanding and relationship about God being in our life. And eventually, what we should experience is that heavy tension and the healing of wounds in our life and that tension leaving our system. And we walk in this world now and not of this world. It used to be we were in the world and of the world. And so we're full of tension and we're full of pain and we're full of sorrow. And when we understand the relationship that we can have and we can enjoy with our Savior Jesus Christ, and we have the recognition of His words that says, I will never leave you. I'm not going to go anywhere. I'm going to be here every moment of your day. I'm available to you every single second that you need me. You call my name and I'm right there. You reach out to me and you're always going to touch me. You try to run to me and I'm going to run to you, and we'll meet quicker than you ever thought we could meet. I want you to know that the world could be going down, but as a result of the promises of God, I don't have to live in the tension of the world. I don't have to live in the pain of the world. I want to encourage somebody today. Put your confidence in the right place. Put your life in the right place. Give yourself over to the things of God. Put your life in His hands and let Him do what He does best. It's all about relationship. It's all about relationship. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's about relationship. And God wants a relationship with each and every one of us. As a matter of fact, He's seeking it right now. He's seeking it right now. All through service, He's been trying to find ways to touch our hearts. And all through service, He's been trying to find ways to get our attention. And so he moves in softly, and He moves in an excited way, and He moves past us that we might feel Him and we might sense Him. He's trying to get our attention. He's courting us, and he's trying to change our eye trajectory from a downward to an upward. And this morning when we were in His Word, and then we begin to worship Him, and then we begin to pray into Him, and then we begin to worship Him, and now we're in His Word. What is all this about? All this is about is revealing Him that He might be known to you, and that He's trying to tell you, you don't have to leave this place by yourself. I want to go with you. You don't have to go back to your job by yourself. You don't have to go back to your home by yourself. You don't have to go back back to the problems by yourself. You don't have to go back to the difficulties by yourself. You may feel like you've blown it. You may feel like you had an opportunity and it's all been blown. But I want you to know, God doesn't feel that way. God doesn't feel that way. He's still available. He still wants to be your friend. He still wants to be by your side. Oh, yes, he does. He wants to. Somebody say, he wants to. He wants to. He wants to. He desires. The Bible tells us that a just man, somebody say a just man. Tell me what a just man is. A just man sounds like he's a pretty good guy, doesn't it? A just man falls seven times, but gets up again. It's not about falling. It's about getting up. It's about getting up. I don't want you to view God as someone who's standing on the precipice of heaven looking down and he's saying, you did it again. I'm out of here. That's not God. That's not my God. That's not my God. And if it's your God, you got the wrong God. That's not the God. That's not the God in this Bible. That's not the God in this Bible. Now, God hates sin. And he'll deal with sin, but he loves the sinner. And he deals with the sinner with love, care, compassion, and gentleness. He'll deal with sin with the baseball bat, but he'll take the person and he'll very gently come alongside and say, I want to be with you. I want to care for you. I want to love you. That's what he does, and he pursues us. Turn to your neighbor and say, he's pursuing you right now. He's pursuing you right now. Turn to your neighbor and say, he's pursuing you right now. Are you running from him? Or are you running towards him? Hallelujah. Come on, what are you doing? Are you running from him? Or are you running towards him? Because he's in pursuit of you right now. What are you doing with your days? What are you doing with your weeks? What are you doing with your months? As he's running towards you, and he's pursuing us. He's pursuing us. Because he's a friend, and he's a friend full of grace and truth. Full of grace and truth and mercy. What a friend we have in Jesus. All my griefs and sins to bear. What a friend, what a friend, what a friend we have in Jesus. He's pursuing each and every one of us. He's like that friend that won't stop the friend requests. He's like that friend that you want to know, how'd you get my cell number? He's like that friend that sends daily devotions that are 16 pages long every day. Don't get irritated with him. He's pursuing you. He wants to love you. He wants to care for you. He wants to walk with you. He wants to show mercy and grace to each and every one of us. So we might feel troubled. Well, there might be an aspect in our life that we feel weighted down. It might be a family issue. It might be a work issue. It might be a health issue. It might be an addictive issue. We might be troubled in our life and we might be weighed down. We might have pressures that we're experiencing in our life. We might have marriage pressures, job pressures, family conflict. And what does this do? This makes us weary. And it makes us tired. And when we're weary and when we're tired, we only have enough energy to give to one place and not multiple places. And so we end up giving all of our energy to the things that are temporal. We end up giving all of our energy to the things that are fleeting. We go and we do our job because we got to pound out the hours, because we got to get the paycheck, because we got to pay the bills that keep mounting up. It becomes overwhelming.
it becomes wearisome. And we become weary with the conflict. We become weary with the waiting, weary with the fighting, weary with the walking and running. We're just weary, weary, weary. How many can be honest with me this morning and say, yeah, I've experienced that weariness? I want you to know that what we really need in our life in those moments, we don't need a message. We don't need some instruction. We need a friend. We need somebody who has compassion, somebody who has care. We don't need somebody to jam a psalm book down our throat and say, sing 12 of these and you'll be all right. What we need is someone to come alongside us in a sweet, in a gentle way, and put their anthropomorphism arm around us and say, everything's going to be okay. You're going to make it, because we're going to do this together. Let me tell you something, that Jesus Christ is the only one that can truly understand all that we may be going through. The Bible says that he was tempted in all points. The Bible says that he wearied, he hungered, he thirsted. The Bible says that even the ones that were closest to him did him wrong. He experienced all of the pain and the suffering and all the emotional anguish that we may have or will experience in our life. So he understands. He understands. And Jesus issues the invitation to weary people, to people that are tired of running and tired of fighting, and they're looking for the answer. You know, you may not be experiencing some of the more traumatic things that I have mentioned, but you may be just experiencing boredom. Like, is this really it? Is this really the life? I mean, is this really what marriage is? Is this really what parenting is? Is this really what working? Have I got to do this the rest of my life? You may just be experiencing the boredom because there's something missing. So you've got the side that's experiencing conflict, and we need that understanding, compassionate God to come alongside us. And maybe you have the side of, wow, is this it? Is there no more to life than this? I mean, I was running full speed through high school and college and getting my career and getting married, and now what? I got to tell you, there's more. There's more. And so we need a friend to come alongside us and open up a whole new world of understanding and excitement to us. So wherever we find ourselves, no matter what is going on, God gives the invitation. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, he gives the invitation when he says, come unto me. I think that's a very, very important part of the verse when he says, come unto me. Brother Titus, he's not saying go down to the store. He's not saying go try to find another girlfriend or a boyfriend. He's not saying go down the prescription aisle. He's not saying try to find another job. He's saying come unto me. Because no doubt across this room, at different aspects of our life, we have tried all those other things only to be left empty. So he starts by saying, just come unto me. And he identifies us. He says, those that are laboring through life, like just grinding it out day by day and dissatisfied and discontent, or those that are heavy laden, you're carrying stuff in your life, you're being weighted down and you're burdened by things, he says, That alcohol, that'll drain off and you'll be back to your heaviness, your labor, and being burdened. Those drugs, yeah, they'll take you away for a minute, but they won't help you for very long. That relationship, that's more trouble than it's worth. Walking away from something of responsibility, that just creates all kind of more problems in your life. But see, these are the only things we know. These are the human responses to traumatic events in our life or difficult things or the boredom of life. So we seek and we try to find. And Jesus says, why don't you come to me? If you're experiencing these things, why don't you come to me? He says, and the result of coming to me is rest. I can give you rest. I can give you rest. He says, in verse 29, he says, take my yoke upon you. Now that's an Old Testament, Old English kind of imagery. Would that be personification? No. It's not. It's close to zoism, zoopomorphism, because it deals with animals. I don't know what it is. But he certainly doesn't mean take a piece of wood and put it over your neck. So it's imagery at the very least. What he's saying is, when he says take my yoke upon you, what he's saying is saying, join me. Let's link up. He's saying, you don't got to do this by yourself. I'll do it with you. We'll walk together. And when you don't have the strength, because we're linked, it'll be my strength. And when you don't have the direction, because we're linked together, it'll be my direction. He says, take my yoke, link up with me, join me, and learn. Learn a brand new way. He says, I'm meek and lowly in heart. He says, I'm not gonna damage you. I'm gonna love you. I'm gonna love you. And what's the promise at the end? He says, and you'll find rest for your soul. So what is he saying? He's saying, come to me, learn from me, and receive from me. Come to me, learn from me, and receive. Let's all stand. It's very, very challenging to find friends today. Can I tell you, your Facebook page does not represent friendship? It says it, but it doesn't represent it. All those hearts and all those likes, they don't mean anything. You know what all that stuff is? It's for them, not for you. They're looking to participate. So it's hard. I had somebody come up to me and says, I was at a conference and I said, somebody came up to me, hey, I heard you Pastor Sean Libby. I said, yeah, I'm Pastor Sean Libby. How are you? He goes, yeah, I know your son. Well, hang on, you're talking to me, all right? Let's focus here just for a second. I said, oh, really? Okay, that's cool, yeah. I said, which one? I only have one. He said, oh, yeah. And I'm like, all right, feed him a little more line here. Feed him a little more line. Let him run a little bit. I said, oh, where'd you meet him? Now, I'm being a little more dramatic for you, but these are the words I said. He said, we're friends. Funny. Martin never mentioned you to me because he mentions everything to me. He said, we're friends on Facebook. I said, oh! I come back to Martin. I said, hey, man, I met one of your friends. He said, who? And I said, you know, so he goes, I never heard of that name before in my life. And I said, well, that's right. It's hard in this day and time that we're living to find a friend. And it's important. It's important in this level. Because in order to find a friend, you've got to be friendly. Isn't that what our verse says today? To find a friend, we have to be friendly. Can I tell you that the most friendly person is Jesus Christ? The most friendly person is Jesus Christ. With our hands lifted, maybe you've been searching for a friend. Maybe you've been looking for a deeper, more meaningful relationship. Can I tell you, it's hard and it's rare on the horizontal plane, but it is guaranteed in the vertical. Searching for a friend who will stick with you through the good and the bad, and the ugly, the ups and the downs. Searching for a friend that wants to come alongside and walk with you. It's really only going to be Jesus Christ. And I want you to start that relationship with Him. To come to Him, to learn from Him, and accept from Him. Maybe you allowed that relationship at one time. Maybe you had that relationship at one time. And maybe your friendship with Jesus has faded just a little bit. Can I tell you He hasn't pushed you away? Can I tell you that He hasn't left to go be friends with somebody else? Can I tell you that He hasn't been offended, but that His arms are still open wide and He wants to rebuild that friendship that He once had? He stands ready to receive new friends, and He stands ready to reconcile past friendships. Because Jesus Christ is the friend that sticketh closer than a brother. In Jesus' name. Why don't we just say, thank you, Jesus, for your friendship. Thank you, Jesus, for your love. Thank you, Jesus, for your kindness. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. So this is all a very, very spiritual process. Coming unto Him, learning of Him, and receiving of Him. It's all a very spiritual process. But as we understand the Bible, that the spiritual things of the New Testament can be seen by the physical things of the Old Testament. And so we see that process of physical things transitioning into spiritual things. We see that. So this is what I really, really want. That friendship with Jesus Christ is done by this verse in Matthew, which is, come unto Him. To have a friend, Brother Astley, but to have a friend, you got to be friendly. That's the hardest thing to do. Right? All y'all sitting next to people you know. You're not sitting next to somebody you don't know. That's the hardest thing to do. If you don't know them, you didn't talk to them all service. I'm just telling you, it's the hardest thing to do. So what you got to do is you got to get over that, and you got to come over to somebody. And you got to say, you got to be vulnerable. And you got to say, hey, I just saw you over here. Thought I'd just come and say hello and introduce myself.
I'm glad you introduced yourself.
You look like a kind of person I'd like to hang out with.
Oh, shucks, maybe.
But I got to get over that. Grab the hand of the person that's next to you. And I want you to pray for this person. I want you to say, help us, Lord Jesus. Help my friend. Help my neighbor. Help my family member. Help us to learn to come to you. I want you to pray that. Help us to learn to come to you. Help us to learn from you. And help us to receive from you. That, Lord Jesus, that we would become friends. But I've got to start that spiritual process in the physical. I've got to start that spiritual friendship in the physical. And so, ladies and gentlemen, in that physical piece, I would love for you to do that first step of the three. Come to Him, learn of Him, and receive Him. And if you want to be a friend to Jesus, and Jesus be a friend to you, I wonder if you in the physical can make your way down to the altar, and it would be an indicator of a spiritual decision and a process that begins in your life. Just come as close as you can, all the way as close. With your hands lifted up and say, Lord Jesus, I want to be a friend to you, Lord God. And I want you to be my friend, Lord God. Yes, come close, come close. And just with your hands, just 5 minutes. Just 5 minutes. With your hands up, say, Lord Jesus, the weariness, the burden, Lord God, the heavy laden. Only you, God, can help me with it. Only you, Lord Jesus. In Jesus' name. With our hands lifted, I love you, Jesus. I worship you, Lord God. I want to learn of you, Lord Jesus, and receive from you, Lord Jesus. Oh, yes, Jesus, 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 Jesus. I love you, Lord. I worship you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for your friendship, Lord God. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your friendship, Jesus. Oh, yes, God. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord.
Thank you, God.
Oh, yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus, Jesus.
Oh, what peace we often flow.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
What needless pains we bear.
Oh, because.
This is the hard part, but I want you to share something with your new friend. It's a time of vulnerability, but it's also a time that deepens the relationship. You can't deepen the relationship without being vulnerable. Because what you're saying is I'm willing to trust you, and I'm willing to hand you some of me. So, with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, I want you to pray, and I want you to communicate with the Lord. I want you to tell Him something personal. I want you to say, Lord, I've been weary in this, and I need your strength. And Lord, this situation is going on in my life, and I need your help in it. I want you to tell Him something. Be vulnerable to the Lord just for a moment, and allow God to join you in your situation and in your time of need. Thank you, Jesus. Lord God, this thing on my job is really bothering me. And this thing that's going on in my home, God, is challenging. Lord, in my relationship, I'm weary with this pain and suffering, Lord God, through my health and sickness, God. I need to tell somebody, and I'm telling you, Lord, my friend, my new friend, Lord Jesus. I'm asking you, Lord God, to just gently, Lord God, embrace each and every one of us today. That we might feel, God, that gentle strength that comes from friendship with you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now the Lord says, learn of me. You can trust me. The Lord says, learn of me and receive from me. And God wants to give healing, and He wants to give strength, and He wants to give grace, and he wants to give mercy. Hallelujah. This is a process. This is the beginning of a process in our life as we learn to trust in him, our new friend in Jesus. So now where we're standing, grab that friend's hand that you have next to you, your family member, and let's pray. Lord, help us to receive from you, God. As we walk this life and as we walk this broken world, help us, Lord Jesus, as we come to you and we learn of you, help us now to receive from you. Lord God, receive direction. Help us to receive strength. Help us, Lord God, to receive what we need in our life for what we're going through and the challenges, Lord Jesus, that we deal with. But as a friend, God, we've got this relationship, and I thank you for it, Jesus. I thank you for it, Jesus. God, I ask you to bless every congregant here today. Everyone that is here, I ask God that you would surround them with your grace and mercy, your protection and your care. I ask, Lord God, that you would go with them and they would feel safe in your hands, Lord God, and satisfied, Lord, in your presence, Lord Jesus. I thank you for it, Jesus. In your precious name we pray, and everybody say amen. Amen. If this is your first, second, third, or fourth time being here, we welcome you. We thank you for being here, and we would love to greet you. I know it's a little late, but if you'll stop by our guest reception right outside that exit door right there, we'd love to answer any questions, get to know your name, us to introduce ourselves to you. There's some refreshments there. God bless each and every one of you. In Jesus' name, have a good afternoon in your new friendship with Jesus Christ. As you develop that and honor that in Jesus' name.
Build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up. It's your church, build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up. We're your church, build your church, build your church.